of sing a new song to the Lord, for he has worked wonders in the sight of the nations. He has shown his deliverance. Alleluia. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. And welcome, as we gather in church, welcome to those who join us in the live stream, where I can see that you've got very clearly in the background of the picture, the banner of St. Joseph. We believe it was a banner originally used down in the church when we were in Chertsey Street, found in a cupboard the other day. We put it out not as a guide or a reminder to where you are, St. Joseph's Guildford, but rather because yesterday was St. Joseph the Worker, and we're allowing the celebration of that, our patronal feast, to spill over into the joy and celebration of this fifth Sunday of Easter. We come to reflect again on the extraordinary gift of the Lord's resurrection. We come to hear the gospel challenging us to bear fruit. And as we begin this Mass, we acknowledge, therefore, our need of the Lord's strength and his inspiration and his mercy. You were sent to call the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy. You were sent to heal sinners. Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy. And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sin, and bring us to everlasting life. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. So let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, constantly accomplish the Paschal mystery within us, that those who are pleased to make new in holy baptism may, under your protective care, bear much fruit and come to the joys of eternal life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
From the Acts of the Apostles. When Saul got to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him. They could not believe he was really a disciple. Barnabas, however, took charge of him, introduced him to the apostles, and explained how the Lord had appeared to Saul and spoken to him on his journey, and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. Saul now started to go round with them in Jerusalem, preaching fearlessly in the name of the Lord. But after he had spoken to the Hellenists and argued with them, they became determined to kill him. When the brothers knew, they took him to Caesarea and sent him off from there to Tarsus. The churches throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria were now left in peace, building themselves up, living in the fear of the Lord, and filled with the consolation of the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You, Lord, are my praise in the great assembly. You, Lord, are my praise in the great assembly. My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and shall have their fill. They shall praise the Lord, those who seek him. May their hearts live for ever and ever. You, Lord, are my praise in the great assembly. All the earth shall remember and return to the Lord. All families of the nations worship before him. They shall worship him, all the mighty of the earth. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust. You, Lord, are my praise in the great assembly. And my soul shall live for him, my children serve him. They shall tell of the Lord to generations yet to come, declare his faithfulness to peoples yet unborn. These things the Lord has done. You, Lord, are my praise in the great assembly.
A reading from the first letter of St. John. My children, our love is not to be just words or mere talk, but something real and active. Only by this can we be certain that we are children of the truth and be able to quieten our conscience in his presence, whatever accusations it may raise against us, because God is greater than our conscience and he knows everything. My dear people, if we cannot be condemned by our own conscience, we need not be afraid in God's presence. And whatever we ask him, we shall receive, because we keep his commandments and live the kind of life that he wants. His commandments are these, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and that we love one another as he told us to. Whoever keeps his commandments lives in God, and God lives in him. We know that he lives in us by the Spirit that he has given us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Make your home in me as I make mine in you. Whoever remains in me bears fruit in plenty. Alleluia. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that bears no fruit, he cuts away, and every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes to make it bear even more. You are pruned already by means of the word that I have spoken to you. Make your home in me as I make mine in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit all by itself, but must remain part of the vine, neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever remains in me, with me in him, bears fruit in plenty. For cut off from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is like a branch that has been thrown away. He withers. These branches are collected and thrown on the fire, and they are burnt. But if you remain in me, and my words remain in you, you may ask what you will, and you shall get it. It is to the glory of my Father that you should bear much fruit, and then you will be my disciples. The Gospel of the Lord. My father, who I haven't been able to see since the beginning of lockdown for medical age reasons, tunes in to this live stream, and I think likes it when there are some familiar references to family life or whatever. So can I say good morning, Dad? And I hope you won't mind if I talk for a moment about you and Mum in the garden. To say Mum was the gardener, Dad was the labourer. And Mum's instructions were very clear, especially when it came to the pruning. Dad would be allowed, if allowed at all, to gently remove some of the dead wood, to be careful to follow the rules. The gardeners here will know better than I. You know, you find the node or whatever it's called, you cut above or below. I'm bluffing slightly to suggest I know how these things work, but there is a whole rule book about how it should be done. Very sadly, my mother died, and Dad was left to use his own judgment. I went home one day, and as I parked in front of the house, I noticed he was pruning the pink climbing rose that goes up the front of the house around the window. I say pruning. It was much more of a slash and burn exercise, as he cut great chunks out of the climber, and has heard, it seemed, talking to himself, saying, "Yes, I know, but there you are, what can you do?" As he realised I was listening, he said to me, "It's all right, I was talking to your mother. I know somewhere she is saying to me, 'Kevin, just a little bit, and I'll pay for it one day when she'll be able to tell me what she thinks, but for now, let's see what happens.'" What happened was the most tremendous display of roses that year. The climber responded magnificently to this all-out attack, and it came back fighting with vigour. Of course, even if we know the theory, it's very hard to have the confidence to put it in practice. When I cut down roses in the garden, my instinct was to follow Mum, trim a little bit here and there, but it doesn't work nearly so well. Perhaps is how we like to be with ourselves too. A little careful, a little trim here and there, nothing too challenging, safer to be modest. This morning's gospel is, of course, not about roses, but about vines. It's a powerful image that the Lord gives, especially when you reflect on the place that vines had in the culture at the time. This is not about what will or may not make the garden look pretty. This is about the production of the fruit of the vine, the livelihood of many of those who were listening, at the heart of many elements of their culture. The Lord's words are being spoken in the context of the Last Supper. He has taken the cup filled with wine and commanded, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant." And of course, it's his blood that will be shed. He himself, as it were, will be cut down. The care of the vine is of crucial importance. Vine dressers know that they must prune, the only hope if it is to produce its precious fruit. In the analogy we've just heard, we are the vine, the Father, the vine dresser, who cares desperately that we produce fruit, who knows that pruning is our hope, and on occasion not just a trim but a challenge. It's even there, and every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes to make it bear even more. The first reading reminds us of one of the most dramatic examples of that life challenged, pruned by God, and the fruit that it bears. Saul has come from an extraordinary place. We are told, and we heard during this past week, that he approved of the killing of Stephen, actively persecuting Christians. But now his conversion, his pruning on the road, has changed his life beyond imagination. Even the apostles find it hard to believe that such change is possible. But he is now part of the vine. And through the courage of Barnabas, they come to see the incredible fruit that he will bring forth in his preaching and in his witness. During Lent, we were challenged to be open to that pruning of the gospel. This Eastertide, we are now invited to bear fruit. This is not a passive season where we simply give thanks to God for the resurrection and move on. We are called to follow in the footsteps of Paul and the apostles, to declare openly what we have seen and heard, perhaps like Barnabas, to have the courage to step out, even in the most unlikely of circumstances, trusting that it will bear fruit. We may be tempted to play safe, just a little trim, but the words of the Lord are quite uncompromising. We have to remain in him, and with him in us, and we in him, we will bear fruit in plenty. For cut off from the vine, we can do nothing, but as part of the vine, we can bear much fruit. And so we profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Our prayers of the faithful, as you know, part of evening prayer this evening at 6:30 on the live stream. If you have any intentions, do please send them, office@cpg.church. Meanwhile, I invite you to sit as we give thanks to God for the fruit of the vine. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we've received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we've received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become our spiritual drink. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. O God, who by the wonderful exchange effected in this sacrifice have made us partakers of the one supreme Godhead, grant, we pray, that as we have come to know your truth, we may make it ours by a worthy way of life, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. 'Tis truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time, above all, to lord you yet more gloriously when Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed. For with the old order destroyed, a universe cast down is renewed, and integrity of life is restored to us in Christ. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, We offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Richard, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who've fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. the body of Christ.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Graciously be present to your people, we pray, O Lord, and lead those you've imbued with heavenly mysteries to pass from former ways to newness of life, through Christ our Lord. A couple of things to mention. Apologies that the parish email went out late. I'm afraid I managed to get it stuck in the outbox as a draft. But if you've now received it, hopefully, one of the things perhaps to highlight is that for this month of May, we're being invited by the congregation in Rome to make sure that it is a real month of prayer, asking Our Lady's support and intercession, particularly in this time of pandemic. They've suggested each day be associated with one of the major Marian basilicas around the world. Great recognition that they suggested beginning with the Walsingham Shrine. So do please make that part of your pattern this coming May. If you would like to come and join us for Mass here in church, there are spaces available during the week. If you're coming on Thursday, do please note that because of the local elections which are happening downstairs in the hall, it's a legal use of a hall at this time. The entrance for Thursday's Mass will be the main doors of the church, unless, of course, you want to go and vote first. Thank you to the IT, thank you to the readers and musicians who've remotely contributed, thank you to the stewards who've made it possible for us to be here today, and thank you to the CYF team. There is a family's liturgy available on the website. Do please go and take part in that. Finally, may I wish you a happy and blessed double celebration. As we merge St. Joseph with this fifth Sunday, and as we celebrate again the resurrection of the Lord, and now as we are sent out in our turn with that commission to go and to bring this news to others. So the Lord be with you. And may Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.